This
Okay, so
conference will now be recorded.
yeah, all right. So let's get into this. So basically, Pega is a tool to develop BPM applications. So before we understand Pega, we need to know what is BPM. So BPM stands for Business Process Management. Business Process Management. Okay, so in order to manage a business, we use a process. Okay, so here, in order to manage a business, we use a process. So process here. So process is something like whenever we do some work, we have a some standards. We have a step-by-step procedure to do this. So the process is nothing but a step-by-step procedure that we follow. All right. So that process is something we inculcate in a business so that we handle it appropriately. All right. So BPM. So there, let's take an example where you apply for a passport. So whenever we apply for a passport, we go with a document, set of documents, register the passport, and whenever we register it, so you will have to wait for you will have to pay some amount. You will give all your documents, and after that, you need to wait for the supervisor or the superintendent who is going to come for verification. So he will do the verification part from here end, okay, and then he is going to give your give the feedback to the appropriate register office, and then there onwards the passport is going to sanction. Similarly for the license. So here, everywhere, wherever you have a different set of people, let's say if you are applying for a job. So in this picture, you see, we as a recruiter who starts recruitment process, so what they do is initially they will get the resume and they will enter that information into the system, and once they enter that information, they schedule an interview with the interview panel. Okay, so your profile first entered by the recruiter. So recruiter is the initial person who is starting your process, so who is starting a recruitment. So then your profile is passed to the second person who is a interviewer. Okay, so the second person could be one or could be multiple as well. So let's say if you have multiple interviews, then one after another, the second person or the third interview will be taken care. Okay, so once the interviewers are cleared, then it is moved to the approvals, where the HR manager approval or a technical manager approval has to approve further for this candidate to take. Okay, so once he is approved, then your profile is getting shortlisted for the onboarding. So that is that you are ready to take for the offer letter. Okay, so this way, actually, the target is to hire a candidate, to hire a for a job. So in order to hire a candidate for a job, so we have different people involved in a in this. Okay, so in this activity, you see, we have four different or three different actors who are involved in it. So BPM is one such methodology where we have different set of people engaged to coordinatively work together to achieve their target. Okay, so the target is to reach a to hire a candidate in this case. Okay, so basically this entire life cycle that we have, it may have multiple set of actors engaged, and BPM is one such BPM is basically to manage all these different set of processes. Okay, so here everything is a process. So let's say the person who is recruiter's his job is to collect the initial documents, to collect the previous employment documents. Okay, so to get in touch with the candidate. So all these are something which are part of assigned to the recruiter. So recruiter is going to take care of all these different type of activities. So once his job is done, then only your profile is passed to the second person. Okay, so here the profile is nothing but the information. The information is the one which we are keeping in a case. So basically, whenever we register, whenever a profile is getting into different set of actors, this has to be passed one after another. Okay, so not two people can simultaneously work together. Okay, so each and every person has his own responsibilities to do. So he has his own roles and responsibilities. He should be involving as according to that. He cannot intervene the job which is assigned to someone else. So that is what BPM it is. Okay, so BPM is basically they have a different set of actors engaged to work together collaboratively to achieve the target. All right, so here, in order to achieve these set of BPM applications, in order to develop these set of BPM applications, it is applicable for every domain, not only for the recruitment, not only for the HR domain. You may apply for a license. So in order to apply for a license, you will have a separate procedure where you need to wait for soft 21 days. You need to come for the driving test and all. So that is also one set of BPM application itself. Similarly, there's a biggest project which Andhra government has started, which is named as ePragati. Okay, so that is also on Pega. So where all the government applications, where we have different set of government applications, all are having the approval set of things. Okay, so all these are the ones which the Andhra government is making it automated by the Pega tool. Okay, so Pega is basically a leader of BPM. So Pega is one of the top tool in the BPM application development. Okay, so though we have multiple softwares, multiple tools available to develop these set of BPM applications, still why people are choosing Pega? Okay, so it is standing as a leader of BPM since last 10 years. Even prior to that, I'm not aware of, but before that also. So Pega was introduced in 2000. Okay, so in 1990s itself, but still like Pega is not that familiar during those days. Why? Because Pega is basically driven on Java. Okay, so Pega platform, Pega tool, which is developed, it is developed by using Java technology. So underlying technology, underlying platform which is used is Java. Okay, so Java is a software that is used for writing this Pega software tool. All right, so here, but in order to develop the applications during Pega to 90s, okay, last 90s of starting of 2000, so you need to know about Java. You need to know the basics and the core concepts of Java in order to implement the applications of Pega. Okay, so Pega started its operations with starting from 4.x version only. Okay, so during 4.x version it was developed, but there were very, very, very minimal applications which were developed during 4.x version. Later on, Pega 5.x version was introduced. And this 5.x version, in order to develop the applications in Pega 5.x version, so still there is a lot of things where we need to write down a Java code. So earlier, when Pega interview was taken in 5.x, definitely people were interviewed based on their Java skills, because there is a lot of coding which is required, and Pega 5.x requires those Java coders to implement any BPM applications. All right, so later on Pega 6.x was introduced, and this is very, very minimal for writing the Java code. So this reduced a lot of burden in writing the codes, not only Java codes, not only the scripts. Okay, so everything are given certain components, and using those components, Pega itself is going to write down the code for us. Okay, so it minimizes the time to write down the Java codes and all, and increases the application development. So it is going to have a faster development, quicker way of doing the things. All right, so Pega 6.x version is the one where it started being the leader. Okay, and from there onwards, there is no other obstacles. And later on, Pega 7.x version was introduced in 2012. Okay, so where from Pega 7.x version onwards, so there is a drastic improvement in the applications and the clients usage. So there are a lot of clients who were there on Pega 7.x. They were very much impressed with the 7.x features. Okay, so one is compatibility, browsers compatibility. So what is browser compatibility is, so basically it is supporting in all the browsers. So till 6.x version, it was only supporting in Internet Explorer, and that too in IE 8, less than or equals to Internet Explorer 8 browser version. Okay, but later on when 7.x version was introduced, it is supporting in all the browsers, including the mobile browsers as well, like Safari and all. Okay, so it is supporting in the Chrome, Safari, Mozilla, all the browsers it is supporting. In addition to these browsers, it is even supporting in the mobile devices as well. Okay, so there are mobile app which is introduced so that the customers can utilize the app in order to use the software. Okay, so in order to use the software, the mobile app is also given so that the system, the people can download from the Play Store and they can install this and they can have a registered with the server as well. So once they register it, they can straight away use in the apps directly in the mobiles. All right, so in the apps, in the mobiles, as well as what else, laptops, it is getting supported, and tabs. Okay, so in the tablet devices as well. So basically all the browsers it is having a support. All right, and in addition to this, so what is the key thing which has improved is, so you need not code explicitly for a specific browser. Okay, so whatever the screen that it has, whatever the screen length it has, it automatically adjusts the space according to it. Okay, so let's say if it is a laptop, then whatever the development that you do, the front end that you develop, so it is adjusted as per the space given for it. Similarly, if you use the mobile, as per the mobile screen, how much the space it is, it will adjust according to it. So it doesn't show you the scroll bars and all. Like if you see something like, if I make this screen in a smaller way, okay, so you see we have a horizontal scroll bar here, but this is not ideal way of doing the, not the ideal way of representing the things. The ideal way is automatically it should adjust the space according to the mobile, where it should not getting the horizontal scroll bars. You can even have a vertical scroll bar, where in the mobile, if you see any browsers, wherever the information is there, you will drag the screen vertically, not the horizontal. So horizontal screen is the, not the ideal responsive screen. So responsive screens are always the one which does not have the horizontal scroll bars. All right, so those things are the one which Pega automatically takes care of displaying the things to us. All right, so while it displays the options to us, it will take care of how to display them in the respective browsers. All right, so the browser size, browser resolution could be different. Okay, so some browsers may have 1500 pixels, some may have 1700 pixels, some may have 1020 pixels. Okay, so the laptops or the desktop monitors, so they may have a different set of resolutions, screen resolutions. In spite of it, we doesn't need to explicitly add any code to it. Okay, so it automatically adjusts the space according to it. Now the other thing is case management. All right, now coming to the case management, so basically case, what is a case is, so whatever the record of information, a profile, whenever we take it, so every record of information is called as a case. So here in this example, we see whenever we consider for a recruitment example, so let's say I am a candidate who is appearing for the interview. So as a recruiter, he takes my profile and he passes for scheduling the interview, pass on the profile to the manager approval. So here my profile is considered as a case. So the record of information, the record of information which is passed to the different set of actors. So all these actors are acting on a single case itself. Okay, so this is explicitly for my profile. Similarly, for every profile, they have to create a separate case for it. Okay, so this is basically a case. All right, and here the next thing is, in order to define this, in order to define what is the procedure at each and every step, each and every stage, we call it as. Okay, so here this is basically in order to manage the case. So we have given a stage based case management. So there is a concept called stage based case management where you have multiple stages. So let's say this is one stage where you have different steps performed in this stage. So collectively you are going to collect the steps under each and every stage. Okay, so similarly you will have the second stage where you may take the one or multiple interviews based on the experience of a candidate. All right, so here you are going to define one after another the list of interviews to be taken. All right, so here the list of interviews are going to perform under the stage called interview stage. All right, so once this stage is complete, you may pass on the profile to the next stage where it is having the approval stage. Okay, so this is basically considering all the approvals in this particular stage. All right, and finally you may send an email notification to the candidate and to get the documents and get the joining date and all. All right, so here this is the final stage, which you may call it as a wrap-up stage. So in this way we can divide the things, divide the work which has to be done under each and every stage, so that is eases the tasks, what has to be accomplished and how it has to be accomplished under each and every stage. Okay, so this is basically given a pictorial representation. Okay, so as a pictorial representation, each and every steps are going to be defined under the stage based case management, and those things, before we start doing the development, we try to expose this is your business. So this is how your business flows. So this entire picture is going to be displayed to the stakeholders, okay, or the business users who are actually who wants how the business has to run. Okay, so initially before we start the development, the experts, the business analysts and everyone sit together, they collaboratively discuss that this is how your business will come into picture. Okay, so they does not know how technically you will implement, they just want to see how my business will flow, how it navigates one after another. Okay, so this is a stage based case management where initially before we start doing any kind of development, we pictorially represent the things in the stages, and at each and every stages what are the steps that we involve. Okay, so those things we represent into the stage based case management. So this is a concept which was given in Pega 7.x. okay, so using this people can have a quickly give the business how the business looks to be. Okay, so it avoids making the mistakes. The basic advantage is it avoids making the mistakes, because what happens is in general whenever we start doing any development in the IT industry, so you may have certain communication given by your lead saying that this is what I'm expecting to, but the actual product owners or the actual business users, they are expecting something else. Okay, so definitely the communication which has happened to the lead, he may interpret the data in a different way. So to avoid such kind of mistakes, the stage based case management will help a lot, where initially the lead system architects and the stakeholders, the business users, all will sit together. They collaboratively discuss, this is how my business should be. Okay, so based on that, we are going to give a sign off to start our development. Okay, so that way we have these stages and steps defined before we start doing any kind of development. Okay, so we'll see the power of what all the things that internally Pega will generate instead of we doing the things. Okay, so most of the things are given in the stage-based case management, which eases the development for a developer, as well as it benefits the business stakeholders how it should be going. All right, so that navigation flow, the navigation paths are given clearly in the stage-based case management. We can define clearly in it. All right, and there was multiple improvements given in the concepts of data management in Pega 7.x. Okay, so there is a lot of areas where it was improved. So the other thing, the other key area for the IT industry is to manage our data. So as of now, you see we have a large set of data. Okay, and this large set of data is something very important to manage. So basically, you see we have different set of data tables where we try to add these data tables into a different type of repositories, different type of storages that we have it. Okay, so whenever we try to maintain the data and we try to extract the data, the lot of time consumption happens while we extract or while we do the query operations. Okay, so there is a certain data management concepts which reduces the time between the data to be queried and getting to the user. Okay, so how this is implemented? So there are certain concepts which were introduced in Pega so that it eases to increase the performance of the data, how to manage at the user level. Okay, so there are certain concepts that were introduced in data management, and this eases, this increases the performance of the application by how frequently the data has to be queried, because the maximum amount of time is taken at the doing the SQL query level itself. So the database queries that are written, it will take a lot of time. Okay, so of course we won't write any SQL queries in this tool. By default, tool itself will provide certain controls, certain options where it does write down the query for us. All right, we just need to know how to configure these things. All right, so there is a certain concepts of data management. Of course, there are a few other things which were introduced in Pega 8.x, which is related to the background jobs. Okay, so cloud 8.x major focus is towards the cloud. Okay, so whatever the cloud related things, the cloud, it is going to enhance the applications to move towards the cloud. Okay, so basically why the IT industries are moving towards the cloud is infrastructure. Okay, so most of the applications that we develop it, so it is basically a server has to be set up. Okay, so you need to set up a server, you need a database storage. Okay, so primarily for not only for one environment, you need to set up for a different set of environments, because you see, once we develop a implementation application, then in that case, once your coding is complete, you have to move your code to the next subsequent environments, and the subsequent environments could be multiple, where you will have a test environment, okay, where only testers will test the application. And then it is moved to the pre-prod environment, where there is another team who is going to test the application before we move it to the production environment, and then it will go to the production environment. Few other teams may increase their own servers. So some people will maintain a training environment, which is a replica of which could be the training environment or a break-fix environment. Okay, so basically like a replica of whatever the production which we have it, so that we'll try to maintain separate copies of it. So that way there is a large set of environments that has to set up in every organization. So every organization has to spend a lot of money for these set of operations, for these set of infrastructures. So basically Pega is giving the cloud operations so that the developers or the organization need not spend a lot of money for that. Of course, they need to pay for the cloud operations. So whoever running the cloud, so let's say Amazon is running. So Amazon has their own cloud repository set up and all. Okay, so in the similar way, we have different set of vendors. So the users, the organizations, they can choose a vendor and they can go and save the things in their own repositories, so that it reduces the cost of infrastructure and all. It reduces the burden of we maintain those operations, we maintain those infrastructures and all. Okay, so definitely whenever we have to maintain these servers and all, there should be a separate team who has to handle it. Instead, if we have a cloud operations set up, because this is something which is done only at a remote level, which is done by only the vendor. So vendor, whoever provides the cloud, so they are going to take care of the things. Okay, so cloud anyways, they support the security and all. So we need not care about all those things. So they have their own mechanism whenever the security comes into picture. Okay, so they will have their own algorithms followed in order to secure our data. All right, so they maintains the replica of the data, they maintains a additional copy of it, so that something goes wrong, it will automatically give the second replica or the copy of the data which is restored. Okay, so they takes care of restoration part as well. So that is something which Pega 8.x is focused about. Okay, and Pega 8.x is also bringing certain features related to robotics. Okay, so basically most of the things which are done by the user can be done by the robotics as well. Okay, so wherever, let's say there is an operation where you need to do, so where the users, though, who are the support users, okay, so supporting team, they generally, they will be maintained to check certain things. Okay, so what happens is robotics is one such thing where robots will work as like the users. So how the users are performing, the users will log into the system, they will do whatever the tasks or the work which is assigned to them. In the similar way, robots will have their own login IDs, they will log in with their user IDs, they will work as like the human users. So that set of automations is getting engaged in Pega 8.x. So there are, of course, there are certain hooks provided in 7.x, but there is some more things which are getting more engaged in Pega 8.x as well, so that the users who are trying to implement the robotics feature in applications, they are going to introduce, they are going to give it easily. So they are making it more user friendly. So for this robotics, there is a separate tool and all that they need to install it. And of course, there is a separate lessons that are given for this robotics. But in order to make it more user friendly, they are increasing the scope, increasing the development activities towards the 8.x, so that people can less focused on the Pega side, they can more focus towards the robotics side. Okay, so this is one more thing which was taken care, and there is another thing called auto upgrades. So see here, whenever we are trying to move from one version to another version, so like you are in the, and again, if you see here, when I say X here, X could be 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so there are multiple versions again under each and every version. Okay, so under the 7.1 is there, 7.2 is there, 7.3 is there. Okay, so there are multiple subversions as well. Okay, so for every subversions to be moved, like say if you want to move it from your application is 7.1 version, you move to 7.2 version. So you have a separate procedure to do this. Okay, but in order to do this, you need a certain approvals as well from your management, who is going to, let's go for 7.2 version. It's not like simply you click on something and it will go to 7.2 version. So there's a separate procedure which we have to follow. Okay, so in Pega 8.x, how they are providing is they are providing a one click upgrade, where whenever you want to upgrade your system, say like if you are getting the mobile, if you want to upgrade to a new software or update your new OS version, then how you will get a pop-up message. So you will get a pop-up message where you just click on update, it will automatically update the new version. Okay, so in the similar way, Pega 8.x is also giving us certain options, so only for the privileged users. So those privileged users, then just click on one click, so automatically the system will upgrade. Okay, so right from Pega 8.1 to 8.2, if the users want to move from 8.1 to 8.2, so straight away they can click on that auto upgrade, so that it automatically upgrades to the new version. Okay, so those set of things are getting involved in the Pega 8.x. Okay, and there is something called as hot fixes. So what is a hot fixes? So basically the tool is providing a lot many things, and as part of using the tool, let's say there are certain issues, there are certain bugs which are there in the software while we are doing the development. Okay, so maybe Pega tool which is given for us, they are going to fix those things, they are going to fix those issues. Okay, so while they fix the issue, they need to explicitly ship it to you. So they have to give that hot fix that this is a issue which we found and this is fixed now, you can verify it now. So there is a fix given for the issue which is observed in the tool. So basically there is a process where if you observe an issue, in order to add that issue fix into your system, there is a separate procedure where you need to approach the support team and then they will contact us. Okay, so there is a some procedure which we have to follow in order to get that fix. Okay, and that fix is called as hot fix. Okay, so hot fix is the one which automatically we will be given that this is a hot fix. So there is a page where we can see the list of hot fixes, and as and when it automatically installs those hot fixes as well. Okay, so those set of things, these are just at a high level which were introduced in this versions. Okay, so the version to version difference, that is. All right, so now getting more into this, so of course there are a lot of things that are there right from Pega 6 onwards, the conceptually the same, so in 7.x and 8.x as well. Okay, so most of the clients still were in 7.x version. All right, so people, some of them, they are whatever the POCs they are trying to do it, so they are trying to do in Pega 8.x, and whatever the new features, the new components that were introduced, the people are just trying it out. But since it was introduced in 2012, so it is preferred to have a learning in Pega 7.x, because I show the difference when it comes when to Pega 8.x as well. All right, so here the software which I install in my laptop is 7.x. Maybe in the middle of the course we may move to the new version as well. So here, in order to install the software, there's a zip file which is personal edition given, so which has all the prerequisite softwares embedded in it. So here there's a zip file which you need to unzip it after you download. Okay, so I can provide you the drive link to download. So once you unzip it, you will see the folder 11.5945_p_7.4.0. Just double click on it. You see this is a folder structure for installation drive. So where you just need to double click on this install.batch file, or you can right click and run as administrator. So you need to have administrator rights for installing the software. Okay, so if you are using the office laptops, make sure you have administration credentials given. Okay, so click on run as administrator, you will get a pop-up window where it prompts us where to install the software. By default, it chooses the C drive, You can even go with the same default path C drive itself. So make sure you need at least 5 GB of space wherever the drive that you are choosing. Okay, so go with the C drive if you have enough space in it, or else you can move to the some other drive where you have at least 5 to 10 GB of space. Okay, so take that drive and click on next. Okay, so I will share you one document for the software installation where you just need to select, you just need to go with the next as like a normal software installation how you do. Okay, so it takes around 15 to 20 minutes for listing all the necessary softwares to install in your laptop. So basically it creates a folder called PRPC Personal Edition. So there's a folder which is created, PRPC Personal Edition, where you see the list of all the softwares are displayed here. So basically Pega is running on Java technology. So Pega is a software which is built on Java. So here you can see Java JRE 1.8 version. Okay, the 7.4 version is compatible enough with the Java runtime environment 1.8 version. All right, so here, yeah, please go ahead.
Ravi, sorry to interrupt, I have a quick question. Yeah. So how many clients like do you think that right now they are using to upgraded to 8 from 7.2 or 7.1?
So most of them they are trying to do it, but there are certain challenges in
because of the cloud, right?
Yeah, of course, yeah, because of the cloud. Yeah. So there was another versions which were introduced in 8.x also. 8.1 is there, 8.2 is there, 8.3 is there. So most likely the 8.3 is the one which is recently introduced. 8.2 is the stable version which people are the Pega team is recommending to the clients. Okay, so in case they are trying to upgrade.
So these all take backend server Tomcat or WebLogic?
Generally it supports both the things, not only WebLogic, but Sphere as well. So but this personal edition that we are using, it is bringing the Tomcat server.
Okay,
so it supports even WebSphere, WebLogic, JBoss, all those things.
If I'm not wrong, if you speak robotics, is it you mean RPA?
Yes, OpenSpan RPA. Okay.
That's fine. I just want to make sure.
Okay, so here you will see the prerequisite softwares for this personal edition. So Java is one such thing. So you did not change any settings and all. By default, the path and all, everything is set for us. You did not set any path and all. All right. So here you will see the second prerequisite, Postgres SQL database. So you can see there are certain database tables which it loads by the software. So all the prerequisite data tables are loaded in this. Okay, so there is a small database created for us, which is Postgres SQL database. It is created for this personal edition, but by default it supports any databases like Oracle, SQL, MySQL. So there are whatever the DB2, all the vendors that we have, database vendors that we have, it supports all the databases. Okay, so PGSQL is the one which is used for this personal edition, and here comes the server which is Tomcat. So this personal edition is using the Tomcat server. So where the configurations related to database is already done in it. Okay, so here there is a conf folder where the configuration for the database is already done. So you can see the database details if you go to the context.xml file here. So here you can see the context.xml file where the database details are given here. Okay, so in case if you want to log in to the database, you can use these configurations. You can use this URL, username, password in order to establish a connection and see what all the tables that Pega uses. Okay, but since it is a Postgres, you need to install a Postgres admin software. So there is a separate software which we need to install in order to check this database. Okay, as like you have an Oracle, So for Oracle, you will go with Oracle 11g or whatever the version that you have. So Postgres admin, there is a separate software which you can download separately in order to check the tables which are there in it. Okay, so you can establish a connection and you can see how the team tables are arranged. Okay, so I have installed this in my laptop. So PG admin is the software that we use for this data table connection. So this is basically used for the Postgres. Okay, okay, so I have listed so many. Okay, so basically you can connect to the, you can make a connection by using add a server, going to file, and here you are going to add the details in it. So where you will get it from the context.xml, I have shown you this one. So here you will see we have URL JDBC colon Postgres SQL, localhost is the IP address. So since this is installed in the local, so this is having the IP address as localhost. In general, we'll have some IP address for the database. So that is the thing which we have to take, and the port number 5432. Okay, so here we have to specify the localhost, and the port number by default for the Postgres is 5432. We can go with it, and here the name of the connection. Okay, so we can give some name here, and followed by the maintenance database is Postgres, the username is Postgres, and the password is Postgres. Okay, so here you can see the username and password. So this is having the Postgres. So give the Postgres password here and click on OK. Okay, say OK. So it will connect to that database. So just double click on it. So you can see the expand icon here, where you see the database, the Postgres database. So inside this, you will see the schemas. Okay, so here you will see the schemas. So Pega is basically having maintaining these two schemas, the rule schema and data schema. So these are the two schemas which Pega is going to manage for us. So for every Pega 7 applications, it will have these two schemas, data schema and the rule schema. All right, so here, whatever the development activity that we do it, so here it maintains two schemas. So what is schema is basically a collection of tables. So schema is a name given for the collection of tables. So whatever the tables that we create, it has to be packaged in that schema. All right, so here we have the rule schema and we have a data schema. So these are the two different schemas which we have in Pega 7.x version. Okay, so whatever the development activities that we do it, it will be captured. The tables are going to be there under the rule schema itself. Okay, so all the development related tables are maintained in the rule schema. All the user data is going to maintain under the data schema. So here, let's say if I'm going to capture the information of a recruiter, or capture the information of a candidate. So candidate details are something which I will be have to store somewhere. Okay, so there is a table which has to be maintained under the data schema, because that is something which is a user information. So any user information we maintain under the data schema. So whatever the tables that is going to be that are there in the data schema, those are explicitly meant for storage of data with respect to the user. Okay, so user can update, user can delete, user can add. So that information is something we are going to have under the data schema, whereas the rule schema is all the development related tables. So everything that we do a development is also getting saved. Okay, so whatever the code or whatever the things that we develop, it maintains a separate tables for it, and those things are coming under the rule schema. Okay, so we have two different schemas in Pega 7.x, but whereas in Pega 6 version, we have only one single schema for both rules and data. Both are maintained in a single schema itself. Okay, so here, whatever the rules, whatever the development, and whatever the user data, both are maintained in a single schema itself. All right, so later on, when we are moving to 7.x version, there was two different schemas were introduced where all the development activity tables should be maintained under the rule schema, all the user related data should be maintained under the data schema. Okay, so that way it was given. Later on, now Pega 8.x having three schemas. In addition to the rules and data, we have one more schema, which is customer data. So customer data is basically the external things. So whatever the new tables that we created, okay, so we can explicitly write down certain tables. We can explicitly create certain tables. Okay, so those are something we call it as external tables. Okay, so all the external tables we can maintain under this new schema called customer data schema. Okay, so separately they are providing one more schema where all the external tables, all the tables that we created, we in the sense, of course, we only create these things also, but we are creating these things by using the tool itself. But while we are using the tool will generate those tables. Okay, and it will take care of where to store those things. So automatically it will go inside the data schema itself. But whereas if you are having a external a DBA where you will write down the query for creating certain tables, like create table, table name and all. So you will maintain certain tables, you will create certain tables, you will take care of inserting those things. So those things will be coming as part of a separate schema called customer data. Okay, so we will discuss about those external tables, how to manage and all, how to create and how to manage those things. Okay, but there is another schema which was introduced in Pega 8.x. All right, in addition to the rules and data schema. All right, so here you will expand and see the list of tables that are there in the each and every schema. All right, any questions? All right, so now coming to the scripts folder here. So if you go to the scripts folder, we have a batch files given which are responsible to start the server and shut down the server. For the first time when you install the software, automatically the Tomcat server starts. Okay, so that you can work your operations, but we can work with the URL given by the server start. Okay, once that is done, you will just click on the shutdown.batch file so that it shuts down the server for us. Okay, so for the next time when you come to this, you are going for the startup.batch file. You just need to double click on startup.batch file. So you will see a command prompt window which appears for starting your server. Okay, so here the server, when it starts, it has to start both the servers, database server as well as the Tomcat server. Okay, so whenever your web application, any web application has to run, you should take care of database should be up and running and your server should also up and running. So both should be up and running whenever we are running any web applications. Okay, so here this startup.batch file will take care of starting our database as well as starting the Tomcat server. Okay, so it will take around 5 minutes to start your server, and once the server starts, you have to open any of the browsers and specify the URL, specifying as localhost colon port number, which is 8080. So by default, this port number is given the option during the installation itself. So by default, it chooses 8080. If in case you want to modify this, you can modify it during that time itself. Okay, so you can use either 8080 or you can use 9080. So there are different port numbers. In general, whenever the server is running, server will choose these set of port numbers or 8090 or 9090. So these are the different port numbers that a server chooses whenever the server we try to run it. Okay, so by default you can go with the 8080 unless you are running any other software, any other server in your system. Okay, so here if in case you go by default settings during the server installation without any changes, you can specify localhost colon 8080. Later on you have to specify the servlet context, which is PR web. So for any web application to run, you need to specify the servlet context, and PR web is the servlet context here. Okay, so in order to run the Pega server, so servlet context, we need to specify to see the tool to log in. Okay, so we need to specify this URL and then we need to give the credentials to log in here, which is administrator at pega.com, and password is install. Okay, so these are the credentials that we need to use in order to log in. So you can see here the Pega 7.4.0 personal edition, this is okay. Click on login. And the official website to check the PDN articles or the PDN forum, pdn.pega.com. Okay. So the official website where you can verify any PDN Pega articles and all. So this Pega Developers Network. So you need to sign up for this. Okay, sign up where you see on the top. So just sign up and register to it. Okay, it helps us a lot while we go certifications. And of course, in general, whenever we try something in new in Pega, so you can search in this Pega network. Okay, so you just click on sign up and register for it. Okay, so once you log in, so the space that you see here, this is called as a designer studio. Okay, so designer studio is the name given for this space where this is called as a developers portal as well. So developers who are going to do the development, they have to use certain options which are provided on the top, bottom, on the right side, on the left side. Okay, so these are the options that we use it in order to do the development. Okay, so the space that we are going to use for doing the development is called as designer studio. All right, so this designer studio is the one that we use for doing the development activities. Okay, and whatever the testing that we do it, we are going to test in another portal which we can launch by using this launch web interface. And on click of it, you see there's a new window that it opens. And this is called as case manager portal. This is also called as end user portal. So end customers or end users who are going to use it, so they are going to utilize this portal. Okay, the portal named as case manager portal. All right, so this end user portal, so in general this is Pega provided ones. We can design our own portals as well. All right, so this is basically the end users who are going to do the business operations, the BPM operations, they are going to perform on this space. Okay, so there are multiple options given on the right here and all. Okay, so using these options, they are going to manage the work which is assigned, what they have to do today. Okay, so every day whenever a user comes, they will log into the system. Okay, so they will access these set of options which are given on the right side. What they have to do, so they will see the list of items that they need to do it. Okay, so every day they might have certain things to perform. So, and all these users might have a manager as well. Okay, so in general, the people manager who is going to manage what is that the team has to work today. Okay, so even in the IT industry, whenever you go for any job, you will assign to something that you need to work on. Okay, and there should be a status report for it. So how the team is performing and all, manager will view the reports and all. Okay, so in this way, the different set of options which are given, it is for managing the work and all. All right, so we'll discuss about these things in tomorrow's session. Okay, so we will discuss about the terminologies first before we start creating a new application. All right, so it is around 45 to 50 sessions per day, 1 hour. Okay, and the recordings are provided, and the soft copy I will be sharing in the drive itself. I will be keeping them on the drive, so you can access that drive where the recordings as well as the soft copy notes are added to it. All right, and what else? Yeah, I will provide you one project at the end, so with the best practices how to do it in the real time and all, and interview questions. Whenever we discuss on that specific topic itself, I will give the interview questions. So what kind of questions can come on it? Okay, so if you practice on daily basis, definitely you can crack the job easily, because it's not very difficult as like other programming languages. Okay, so we can easily learn it if you do some kind of practice. Think as if don't compare with any other software programming languages and all. You just think as if this is a configuration tool basically. So whatever we configure, it generates the code in the background. So we just need to know how to configure it, so automatically it generates the code in the background. All right, any questions? Yeah, Anshu, I think you joined in the middle. So I don't know. So you can Anshu and Kumar, I guess. Kumar, you joined in the middle, right? So I will play the recording completely. I think even if you join in the middle, there is nothing. It's a not a chain to follow from the starting. So even you can understand, I guess. Okay. Yeah, Kumar and Anshu.
Yeah.
How do you approach and since the how you get the meeting invite? Via Facebook, or how do you get this meeting invite?
By WhatsApp, actually. I inquiry for pay or training, so I got this fine. Link. For...
Okay, fine. And yeah. How about you, Kumar? Hey Kumar, are you there? Kumaran is there, Kumar is also there. Kumar, both of you are same?
No.
I see. Kumaran, right? Kumaran, I know you. How about Kumar? I see Kumar here. Kumar, can you hear me? Hey Kumar, can you hear me? Okay, Anshu, can you just drop your email ID or contact number? Okay, just send me your contact number once and email ID as well.
Where I have to share?
In the chat window that you see on the GoToMeeting invite. Okay, so just in the chat window, you can drop it to me. Okay. You see Raviraj there, right? So just drop it to me. Yeah. Okay, so I can share you the recording, and the timing is same 7 to 8 in the morning. Okay.
Thank you.
Any questions or anything that you need to know?
Not at all. Nothing. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. All right, then we'll resume tomorrow then. All right. Thanks to everyone.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Thanks, everyone.